If you were going to make a prediction for us about where we could be 20 years from now, do you see AI as having helped us solve our gravest problems, or maybe we don't end up so good on the other side of it?
I think it's important to give you a sense of the quickness that this is happening. I don't think, maybe even this group may not appreciate how fast this is going to happen in the next 5 years. Today you have language to language. That's what ChatGPT, Claude, Gemini are. You can also do multimedia to multimedia. You can do language to language in terms of computer languages, that kind of stuff. Pretty straightforward. Think of it as a language problem, and language has a distinct structure. The next thing, and the technical things that are going on, are huge context windows, agents, and the ability to do text to program, which means that I can say what I want, and then the computer will write the program and run the program. Everybody kind of understands how programmers work. Well, now you have an alternative choice. And it looks like, for example, programming, which a lot of you do, roughly half of your work will ultimately be done by a computer. The question is, how much more than half? It's a pretty big deal, speaking as a person who's been a programmer for 50, 55 years. So that's sort of where we are in 2024. And if you want to look at what this looks like, spend some time with Notebook LM from Google, which I think is the ChatGPT of this year because of what it can do. And especially in your functions, take everything, throw it in, and start seeing what it can do to help you. It's remarkable what is possible now. So the next phase is agents. So right now, it looks like these systems are able to do physics, chemistry, and so forth at the 80 to 90% level of a PhD student in those areas. That's a pretty big deal. I can't do in any one of them, and it can do it in everyone. And the likely scenario is that that stuff gets integrated into a single larger model. At that point, right, it's relatively straightforward to see that that model could become capable of its own decision-making and its own pathing. That's when it gets really interesting. That's all in 5 to 6 years. Now, one scenario is that what is technically known as recursive self-improvement, where it's constantly getting better, is actually banned. And the reason it's banned is it's too dangerous. Another possibility is that there is a competition between the two protagonists, which are the US and China, where even small differences in rate of improvement and literally slope of innovation have huge secondary outcomes. So that sets up a race, and it's a race to dominate intelligence in a non-human form. What's interesting about the race, this is why this is so important, is the slope is like this, right? It's like incredible, right? And the biggest limits right now have to do with NVIDIA chips. You all understand this very well, and energy and infrastructure and so forth. At some point, it'll be possible to have AI scientists that commingle with the human scientists, and then the slope goes up further. When you have something which is growing so exponentially quickly, even small differences in timing have huge secondary impacts. And that will all occur before the 10-year point in your 20-year question. The primary author of this book is Dr. Henry Kissinger. And I don't need to tell this audience who he was and what he did. He died a year ago, which is why we take the time. And he finished the book the week of his death. That's how important this book was for him. And when he talked about it, he would say, here's roughly what happened. When in his prime, which was a long time, he started with a RAND group that essentially developed the ideas of deterrence. Those meetings occurred in 1951, 1952, 1953. The mutually assured destruction architecture was invented during that period. It took more than 15 years to go from the use of a nuclear bomb in Hiroshima and Nagasaki, the explosion of the atomic bomb by Russia in 1949, 4-year delay, and then this very long time to come to an agreement that maybe we should agree. And he was very concerned that this thing is happening so quickly that there will be there's no time to do the diplomacy. Mm-hmm. And I think we're in a similar moment. Mm. So the way to understand this is that I'm describing the timing of this extraordinary invention, and our political systems are just not ready for this rate of change. I'll give you another example. You guys care a lot about economics. For those of you who have PhDs in economics, is there any literature or studies about economic growth where the economic growth on a per year basis goes more than 5 to 10% aside from China's reindustrialization? No. We're talking about productivity doubling in a period of, say, 5 years because of this. Well, what does it do to the economics? So, for example, does it mean a very small number of people control most of the money, or does the wealth diffuse through the society?